You're watching Tag.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with Afghanistan, where the insurgent Taliban have expressed signs of a positive change as they are ready to engage in a dialogue with Kabul establishment if the peace accord with US is signed. The Taliban have also proposed a 10-day ceasefire with the US forces and reduction of violence against the Afghan government. Kabul, however, seeks comprehensive ceasefire as a precondition to any form of negotiations. Let's have a look on the political developments in Afghanistan in past 1 week.
Taliban, the insurgents who have for years rejected the legitimacy of Kabul establishment, have finally softened their stance as they have indicated a yes in engaging with the government. After extensive discussion with the Zalmay Khalilzad-led US team, a satisfied and hopeful Taliban even said that it was ready for an experimental 10-day ceasefire with the US forces and would substantially reduce violence against Afghan government if the deal is hammered out. Although it hasn't expressed the time frame, Taliban says the deal will be sealed soon as US side has agreed to the demands it was earlier apprehensive and dismissive about. The Kabul establishment has, however, categorically rejected the idea, saying a comprehensive ceasefire was the precondition for any kind of talks to take off. President Ashraf Ghani has, however, said that he was content with the way US has consistently backed Kabul in its peace endeavors. He describes US President's style of negotiation different and disruptive.
I have no problems dealing with President Trump. I'm one of the few leaders that has an excellent relationship, including today's conversation. Because I frame my relationship in terms of priorities that he's promised the American people, and he's consistent on that. The question is, how do we find common ground? And where is common ground to be able to move forward? His style is disruptive, meaning that when the status quo reaches a point where it does not produce the results that he wants, he engages in disruptive change. And this is a type of change that we need to increasingly understand.
The reference was about President Trump's abrupt decision of canceling the months-long talks in September after the insurgents' attack killed one US soldier. The talks resumed, but once again put on hold as the Taliban attacked a US base situated outside Kabul. Although there is no consistency in the process, Afghanistan trusts what US does. The winner of the preliminary round and president for 6 years, Ashraf Ghani, believes the war has completely destroyed Afghan economy and the speedy and comprehensive peace process was the only way forward.
We have destructive change on the economy, which the professor has made a lifetime explaining to us. We now have the same sorts of things. So it's either creative change that we can manage together, destructive change, like the waves of Schumpeter, or disruptive change. We need to understand that this is not isolated, it's part of a pattern. And at times, the status quo for certain gets disrupted. What the second, third order, and fourth order consequences of that, or we need to be able to work together.
President Ghani reiterated his government's position in World Economic Forum and called out Pakistan for its consistent support to terrorists who were supporting Taliban in unleashing violence in the country. Pakistani Prime Minister had earlier defended his country, saying they had reigned in terror and his land was no more a sanctuary for terrorism. These claims have, however, been made by him on several occasions, which most countries across the globe have outrightly rejected.
Moving on, journalists in illegally occupied region of Gilgit-Baltistan protested against the government for muzzling their voice and demanded press freedom. They allege that local administration who work at the commands of Pakistan was attempting to curtail media freedom and use all tools at their disposal to block the content that is even remotely critical of the government. We have a detailed report.
हम नहीं मानते
जुल्म के जाबते
हम नहीं मानते
जुल्म के जाबते
Journalists in illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan have taken to the streets against the government. They are protesting against the means and measures being employed by the administration to muzzle the voice of media. They say the local authorities who work at the commands of Islamabad use all tools at their disposal to block the content that is even remotely critical of the government. Any dissent or deviation from the prescribed government line is dubbed treachery and the journalists are made to suffer the damaging repercussions.
We want justice!
We want justice!
We want justice!
We want justice!
صحافیوں کو دبانے کی صحافیوں کے معاشی جو قتل ہے اس کو قتل کرنے کے لیے اور صحافیوں کو جو ہے دیوار سے لگانے کے لیے جو ایک گنونا کھیل کھیلا جا رہا ہے उसकी हम भरपूर मजम्मत करते हैं और हम किसी सूरत भी इसको बर्दाश्त नहीं करेंगे और इसी के साथ जो एक गैर एलानिया सेंसरशिप की जो है यहाँ पर बरकरार है साफ़ी अगर किसी चीज़ पे नुक्ताचीनी करता है उस पे अगर कोई नुक्ता और उस पे कोई एतराज़ उठाता है तो उसको जो है दीवार से लगाया जाता है उसको जो है जेलों में बंद किया जाता है उस पर मुकदमात का सामना करना पड़ता है
Freedom of expression has been systematically muzzled in Gilgit-Baltistan. Journalists are made to pay through different means on daring to indulge in real journalism. Government blocks advertisement to publications that show the grim reality of the region. The government literally scans and blocks the media content and stories of corruption in government departments, exploitation in jobs and suppression in other fields are amongst the first one to face the hammer.
Gilgit-Baltistan ke sahafi baradri bhi apne hukuk ke liye sarapa ehtijaj hai aur sadkon par nikal aaye hain. Wafaqi hukumat Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf ke aane ke baad Pakistan bhar mein sahafiyon ke sath istehsal kiya ja raha hai. Unke izhar-e-rai ki azadi ke upar gair elaniya censorship ki ja rahi hai aur un par mukhtalif qisam ki pabandiyan aayid ki gayi hai mukhtalif jo sahafati idare the unse workeron ko dabav ke zariye nikala gaya hai aur jo media industry hai iske upar ek masnoi qisam ka bohran paida kiya gaya hai
The situation is such that the journalists in the region are finding it hard to meet ends of their day Their earning are meager and the current circumstances are suggestive of even worse in future.
Moving on, the government of India has been relentlessly working through its integrated approach to bring a holistic change in the recently formed Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. In its latest step, the union ministers are having direct interactions with locals to take a stock of the situation and apprise them of government plans of bringing prosperity in the region.
Union ministers of India are on a reach-out campaign to the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Their aim is not just to make locals aware of the steps taken by New Delhi to bring prosperity in the region, but also to bust the vicious propaganda emanating from various international media houses. Kashmiris have welcomed the step as they believe communication is the fundamental process of progress and it was missing earlier.
ये फर्स्ट टाइम मतलब ऐसा हुआ है कि जो कोई यूनियन मिनिस्टर यहाँ पे आया है तो लोगों से लोगों आम लोगों से बात कर रहा है, जो भी डिस्कशन हो रही है, एंड ये वेलकम स्टेप है. दूसरी बात ये कि दैट जो आफ्टर द एब्रोगेशन ऑफ आर्टिकल 370 जो लोगों ने कयास लगाए थे दैट मतलब हालात ख़राब हो जाएंगे, स्पेशली जो हमारे मेन स्ट्रीम लीडर्स थे उन्होंने बहुत सारी प्रोपागेंडा किया था, बट अगर हम आज देखोगे तो एवरीथिंग इज़ नॉर्मल. एंड दूसरी बात तो हमें लगा था कि दैट आर्टिकल 370 समथिंग हैज़ टेकन फ्रॉम अस, बट धीरे धीरे हालात पटरी पे आ गए तो हमें लगा कि दैट आर्टिकल 370 इट वॉज नथिंग, it was just political manifesto for some politician, rest it was nothing.
Government of India has taken several steps to grant all benefits of a federal democracy to the region. It has ensured that the benefit of all government schemes reach the common and needy. The government also says that it has laid out a plan to float schemes that are exclusively designed to benefit the people who were marginalized for years.
हमें एक नया मौका मिलना चाहिए कि हम एक नए कश्मीर को बना सकें, उसे सुधार सकें, संवार सकें. जो ये हमारा जो कश्मीर है ये पूरे हिंदुस्तान की आन बान और शान को बरकरार रखे. इंशाल्लाह हमें उम्मीद है कि हमारे इस इंटरेक्शन से बहुत सारे मसाइल दिल्ली तक पहुंच जाएंगे.
हर मंत्री ग्राउंड में जाके लोगों से मिले, ये क्या ये छोटी सी बात नहीं है, ये बहुत बड़ी बात है हम लोगों के लिए, तो बहुत बड़ी बात है. और आने वाला समय मुझे लगता है कि आने वाला समय हम सोच भी नहीं सकते कितना अच्छा होगा कश्मीर वासियों के लिए.
It is not just the reach out, but nearly all restrictions have been lifted from the valley. The prepaid services on all communication networks have resumed, and there were no administrative restrictions as of today. The immediate aftermath of the revocation of special status witnessed some restrictions on movements, but that too have been lifted in phased manner. Article 370 was a temporary measure in the Indian Constitution that gave special status to former state of Jammu and Kashmir, but kept it away from mainstream and robust growth of the country. The situation has improved significantly in 5 months of its abrogation. The hustle and bustle of markets has returned. The traffic is growing despite sharp dip in mercury.
Moving on to the archipelago nation of Maldives, where the government is seeking an urgent international investment in order to protect its islands from sinking. The government says the international community hasn't paid adequate heed to the sufferings that the Maldives has endured because of the pollution created by the developed and bigger countries.
The tropical Maldives, famous for its palm fringe atolls, may lose entire islands as climate change has severely affected its landmass, eroding and slowly sinking it. The country fears drowning of its large portion as it has not been able to create an infrastructure in absence of sufficient money and material. Maldivian Foreign Minister, who was in Indian capital New Delhi, recently said the Maldives required a quick access to cheap financing to fight the impact of the climate change.
For the small states, it is not easy when the financing mechanisms are established in such a way that in order to obtain finance itself is a marathon. By the time the financing is obtained, we may be underwater.
At the UN climate talks in Madrid in December last year, the Maldives and other vulnerable countries pushed for concrete progress on fresh funding to help them deal with disasters and longer-term damage linked to climate change, but failed. One of the world's lowest-lying countries, more than 80% of the Maldives' land is less than 1 meter above mean sea levels, making its population of around 530,000 people extremely vulnerable to storm surges, sea swells, and severe weather exacerbated by climate change. In 2014, more than 100 of the archipelago's inhabited islands were already reporting erosion, and around 30 islands are identified as severely eroded.
Many islands, the islands have been taken away by the sea. So in order to protect the islands, we need to start building seawalls. it's an expensive thing. But we need it. Some of the islands are being taken away. We can't wait until all of them are taken away.
As a report released by country's Environment Ministry, the Maldives spends around $10 million annually for coastal protection works. However, the estimation says it requires $8.8 billion in total to shield all of its inhabited islands. The United Nations has created a pot to help developing nations called the Green Climate Fund, which has already approved nearly $24 million in funding to the Maldives, according to its website. Some individual nations have also offered help, including Japan, which contributed to a sea wall around the Maldives' capital, Mali.
Moving on. Dance is the hidden language of soul that allows people to get free from the heaviness of their mind and enables them to find peace and solace. Walking on the same trail is a female dancer from Afghanistan who performs as well as teaches the traditional Sama dance to Afghani women to help them fight depression and find inner peace in a war-torn country where dance is still considered a taboo for women. Have a look.
In a conservative war-torn country where it is generally considered taboo for women to dance in front of men, a recently formed dance troupe with female dancers specializing in the Sama dance is breaking frontiers. Twirling in a traditional dress in a studio space in Kabul, the founder of Shohode Arefan Sama dance band, Fahima Mirzai, said, "I do the Sama dance because it gives me mental relaxation." Sama dance is a legacy in Afghanistan. Originating from the 13th century by well-known poet Maulana Jalaluddin Muhammad Balkhi, also known as Rumi, it has spread throughout the Muslim world and is mainly performed by men in dancing and swirling movements.
به نام خداوند بخشاینده مهربان فهیمه میرزایی هستم مؤسس تیم شهود عارفان 23 سال سن دارم لیسانس اداره تجارت هستم و همچنین سما رو به خاطر انجام میتونم که یک مرا آرامش روحی میتونم یعنی مثلا روح میتونم با سما آرامش بگیرم.
In January 2019, Fahima set up her medieval dance school catering to both men and women in the Afghan capital Kabul. Spokesperson for the Information and Culture Ministry, Mohammad Sabir Mohammed, told that this is the first time that there are women dancing Sama in the country. Fahima's troupe, consisting of around 20 members of both men and women, train thrice a week and have participated in several official performances such as local dance festivals. The art form is part of Sufism, which is a mystical form of Islam that emphasizes on the inward search for God and purification of the inner self by focusing on the spiritual aspect of the religion.
برای من خیلی سما خوشایند هست و وقتایی که من سما انجام میتونم حتی در کنار ازی که آرام بخش هست برای من یک سری قصه هایی که من دارم یا جنجال هایی که در زندگیم هست با سما کردن از بین میره.
Fahima, 23, was born in the Afghan capital a year before the Taliban took power. Her family moved to Iran and returned to the country in 2006. Now, the dance pioneer is concerned about the Taliban returning to power in Afghanistan and bringing with it a more extreme form of Islam. The Taliban banned women from playing music or appearing in public with their faces visible when in power from 1996 to 2001. In recent years, women have won crucial rights in Afghanistan, making gains in areas such as social activities, education and work. But with the US increasingly interested in negotiating with the Taliban to end more than 18 years of war, the fear of losing hard-fought freedoms is creeping into Fahima's voice.
کشور وجود داشته اونا هیچ دنیا سیاسفید میبینن از چشم خود و هیچ رنگ دیگر قبول ندارن مواجه شدیم با بعضی هایشان که عملا اگر روبرو نیامدن نگفتن پشت صحنه حرفای زدن که اینا نباید وجود داشته باشه، اینا نباید باشن. چیزی که ما میخواییم بگم، ما برای دور کردن مردم نیومدیم که ما بین مردم اختشاش ایجاد کنیم، ما آمدیم تا مردم رو وصل کنیم.
In December 2019, the pioneering mixed gender dance troupe was invited to perform at a ceremony marking the death anniversary of Rumi and received warm applause. Mirzai says regardless of what happens in the future, she plans to continue leading her troupe on the search for inner peace.
Moving on to India, where the government has been tirelessly working to cleanse and rejuvenate the river through an integrated effort to maintain this firm faith of the people in the purity of Ganga. Apart from extensively carrying out its tasks, National Mission for Clean Ganga, NMCG, has taken up the efforts of sewage treatment plants on the banks of River Ganges in India's Varanasi city. Let's take a look.
Varanasi, a historical city regarded as the spiritual capital of India. It draws Hindu pilgrims who bathe in the Ganga River's waters and perform funeral rites. Along its winding streets are some 2,000 temples, including Kashi Vishwanath, dedicated to the Hindu god Shiva. The city's growing population and a huge influx of visitors has led to sewage generation, which is much higher than its existing treatment capacity. Varanasi generates about 300 million liters per day sewage. Under the Namami Gange program, the National Mission for Clean Ganga has taken up several projects for the treatment of sewage. Work is in full swing to tap major drains flowing into the river and divert them to sewage treatment plants, or the STPs.
Dinapur 140 we have added, 120 MLD in Goitha was also inaugurated, so we have added 260. Another plant of STP is under construction at Ramna for 50 MLD. Ramna will also be complete by March. So once all of them come, we will be actually exceeding 400 MLD capacity with old and new, all this put together.
The existing treatment capacity of sewage in Varanasi has been boosted with the inauguration of 140 MLD sewage treatment plant at Dinapur, built at a cost of ₹235.53 crores. The project, funded by JICA, is the first and the largest sewage treatment project to be implemented under the Namami Gange mission. The treatment plant uses green power from sewage to significantly reduce the carbon footprint, apart from lowering the operational costs.
इसमें बहुत ही लेटेस्ट टेक्नोलॉजी लगाई गई है, जो हमारा सीवेज ट्रीटमेंट का पैटर्न है, वो एक्टिवेटेड स्लज प्रोसेस के थ्रू है, जिसमें हम बैक्टीरिया ग्रोथ करते हैं, और वाटर को उसी लिमिट में हम ट्रीट करके भेजते हैं, जिस लिमिट में हमारे गंगा का वाटर ऑलरेडी हमारा बह रहा है, और यहाँ पे जो हमारा BOD लेवल है, जो इनलेट में है, वो 130-150 है, जो उसकी इम्प्योरिटीज़ है, जिसको हम ट्रीट करके लेस देन 20 अराउंड 15 के MG पर लीटर के अंतर्गत उसको हम भेजते हैं यहाँ से ट्रीट करने के बाद.
The 50 MLD STPs being constructed in Ramana will bolster the existing sewage treatment capacity of the city and take it up to 412 MLD, which is adequate to meet the sewage treatment demand till 2035. This will stop untreated sewage from flowing into the Ganga at Varanasi. Out of 23 drains, 20 have already been tapped. The remaining 3, including Asi, are being tapped through Ramanna STP project.
Varanasi again is very important from the point of view of pilgrims, as you rightly said. That's why we have taken up repair of 26 ghats in Varanasi. We also have an agency regularly cleaning up the 84 ghats of Varanasi twice in a day. So that's why the cleanliness and amenities at the ghats have been improved tremendously, because that's a place where really thousands and thousands of people visit every day.
To the Hindus, the Ganga is a sacred river, and any town or city on its banks is believed to be blessed. Varanasi is a veritable paradise for the pilgrims who throng the ghats of the river for spiritual reward, deliverance from sin, and attainment of nirvana.
The river is being rejuvenated and conserved through a holistic approach. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
number one multicultural channel. This is Tag TV.